Majesty. Worship his majesty. Unto Jesus be all glory, honor, and praise. Majesty, kingdom authority, flow from his throne unto his own, his anthem raise. So exalt, lift up on high the name of Jesus. Magnify, come glorify Christ Jesus the King. Majesty, worship his majesty. Jesus who died, now glorified, King of all kings. Jesus who died, now glorified, King of all kings.
Amen. Well, good morning and welcome to Northside. Whether you're here in person or online, we're glad you're with us. Take a moment right now to let us know you're here by filling out our digital connect card at nscoc.org/connect. And as we're getting started, go ahead and share the live stream on social media and invite a friend. If you're joining us at live.nscoc.org, be sure to greet each other in the chat section. I always am encouraged to see the comments that are being made there. You can follow along with today's service in the YouVersion Bible app, where you'll find song lyrics, scripture readings, and more. As you came in today, you might have seen a sign with a QR code. If you scan that code with your mobile device, that will take you directly to the YouVersion event. There's also a link there to view the sheet music for the songs that we'll be singing today. So if you like to read music, be sure to check that out. There's also a link in our weekly email that goes out every Friday in case you'd like to print it out at home. Would you stand with me and join us in this reading as we begin? Let's stand together. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Let's sing together. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Let every kindred, every tribe on this terrestrial ball, to him all majesty ascribe and crown him Lord of all. To him all majesty ascribe and crown him Lord of all. Oh, that with yonder sacred throng we at his feet may fall, we'll join the everlasting song and praise him Lord of all. We'll join the everlasting song and praise him Lord of all. At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow. At the name of Jesus, every tongue confess. At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow. Every knee shall bow at his name. He is the wonderful counselor. He is the mighty God. He is the everlasting Father. He is the Prince of Peace. At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow. At the name of Jesus, every tongue confess. At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow. Every knee shall bow at his name. There is no other name, no name by which we're saved. There is no other name but Jesus. At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow. At the name of Jesus, every tongue confess. At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow. Every knee shall bow at his name. Every knee shall bow at his name. Every knee shall bow at his name. Amen. Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise, the glories of my God and King, the triumphs of his grace. My gracious Master and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread through all the earth abroad the honors of thy name. Jesus, the name that charms our fears, that bids our sorrows cease. 'Tis music in the sinner's ears, 'tis life and health and peace. He breaks the power of canceled sin, he sets the prisoner free. His blood can make the foulest clean, his blood avail for me. Hear him, ye deaf, his praise ye dumb, your loosened tongues employ. Ye blind, behold your Savior come, and leave ye lame for joy. Amen. Would you be seated, please?
Not long after what we call the triumphal entry, we read about Jesus gathered, and there are several folks among him. And there's a section there in John chapter 12 where he talks about, whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, my servant also will be. My Father will honor the one who serves me. And a little bit further down, A few more lines down, Christ says, "But I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto myself." And this morning, as we gather around this small table, we recognize that we're all drawn here for a reason. We're drawn here because of the impact that Christ has had in our lives. Or we're drawn here, maybe Christ is not in your life yet, but you continue to be interested and drawn to what it is, why it is that we gather as a family, why it is that we're drawn here, and ultimately we're drawn to Jesus. Jesus' sole purpose, God's sole plan for his son Jesus was that we, his people, would be drawn unto him. And this morning, as we talk about this sacred moment, as we think about this moment that we take time each Sunday to be a part of and to take this bread which represents his body and this grape juice that represents his blood, let us not forget why we are drawn to him. And not to take away from this sacred moment, but a few months ago or a few weeks ago, you heard David talk about how we want to have this missional mindset. And so what I want to challenge you guys to think about this morning as we look at, and we'll be talking more in months to come about being a more missional church and how that looks. What I want you to think about this morning, not to take away from this moment what it means for us, but what I want you to think about is, from a missional standpoint, what does this moment mean for other people that aren't here? Maybe not physically, but even people that you know. Because we all interact with people on a daily basis. We interact with people at work and at school and bumping into people in the store. And what I want to know is what are we doing ourselves to draw people to Jesus? What are we doing to give others the opportunity to experience this right here? Because amongst everything else that goes on in our daily lives, this is all that really matters. This is all that really matters. And so we need to be focused on drawing others to Jesus. We need to be focused on others being able to have this opportunity. And it might not always be in the walls of this church. As we talk about being missional down the road, start thinking about the people that you want to reach out to and allow them to share in this moment. Because having a moment of sharing the body of Christ, of taking communion, might look different, especially in this world, but it might look different for us to draw others to Jesus for Jesus. It might mean that we are sharing this Lord's Supper around a table, metaphorically speaking, that might be out on the streets under a bridge with loaves and fishes. It might be on the corner of a beaten down apartment building with people just that want to be loved. It might be in your own house, in your own neighborhood, around your friends and your neighbors that, for all we know right now, are longing for this moment, but they'll never have it if we don't take that opportunity to draw others to Jesus, like you're drawn to Jesus right now. I want you guys to just think about that this morning. As we go to our Father in prayer, I'm going to say one prayer for the bread and for the cup. And you guys know the routine with your little cups here. So please think about how you're drawn this morning and how you can draw others to Jesus. Because he wants so many more people to be able to experience this relationship. So many more people. And he calls us to serve him in that way. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning. We thank you for this time that we have, this opportunity that we have to stand here and to be in your presence. To know that you sit on your throne and that we can fall at your feet and give you all praise and glory and honor. Often, God, we take this moment and we don't recognize enough what it truly means. And we ask this morning, God, that you would just refocus our hearts and refocus our minds on what what this small piece of bread symbolizes, what this small little cup of grape juice symbolizes. It has so much greater meaning. And God, sometimes we just get focused on routine and logistics of order and where things fall and when we do it, but we don't take time enough to really think about what this bread and this juice symbolizes. And God, so may we be focused this morning as we go into the rest of this service. May we be focused on this is why we are here. This is why we are gathered for in this place as a family for no other reason but to serve and to glorify Jesus. God, prepare our minds for the rest of this service. Give us thoughts that are focused on you and your son, Jesus, and may we not be distracted by the things that we have going on at home or in our lives or in work or anything else, but God, in this moment, this one time, this moment right now, God, may we be focused on Jesus. May we be drawn to you because we long to serve you. We long to serve you in so many different ways. But God, may you also remind us and may you put in our hearts a desire to serve and draw others to you as well. God, may others have the opportunity to know and love Jesus. And may they not lose that opportunity because we choose not to serve. But God, give us hearts that want to serve so that others can share in this sacred moment of communion. May we not be afraid to share this moment with others, whether it's sitting around a table in our own home, whether it's standing out in the street serving the homeless. God, may we not wait for this moment to be just this Sunday morning when we gather in these four walls, because we know, God, that there will be people that will never step foot in these walls, but they would sit around our table in our own house and share this moment if we will offer it to them. And God, that is what we want to do. We want this moment to be sacred, not just to us, but to our friends and our family and those that we interact with each and every day. God, may we take this time to focus on you and focus on the ways that others can be a part of your kingdom. Thank you so much for your son, Jesus. Thank you so much for his sacrifice. Thank you so much that he lived this earth as a man. And he understands the trials and the tribulations. And even more so, he understands those far greater than many of us will ever come to understand. But we thank you, God, that you gave your son Jesus for us in this time. And it's in his most holy and precious name that we pray. Amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see.
Good morning. I'll be reading from Matthew 18:23-35. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. As he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 bags of gold was brought to him. Since he was not able to pay, the master ordered that he and his wife and his children and all that he had be sold to repay the debt. At this, the servant fell before him. "Be patient with me," he begged, "and I will pay you back everything." The servant's master took pity on him, canceled the debt, and let him go. But when the servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 silver coins. He grabbed him and he began to choke him. "Pay back what you owe me," he demanded. His fellow servant fell to his knees and begged him, "Be patient with me and I will pay you back." But he refused. Instead, he went off and had the man thrown into prison until he could pay the debt. When the other servants saw what had happened, they were outraged and went and told their master everything that had happened. Then the master called the servant in. "You wicked servant," he said, "I canceled all the debt of yours because you begged me to. Shouldn't you have had mercy on your fellow servant just as I had on you?" In anger, his master handed him over to the jailers to be tortured until he should pay back all he owed. "This is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother or sister from your heart."
Kind of a good news, bad news thing first as we start. The good news is that Bob and Jane Brumley and their family are here. They've been gone a couple of years, right? Been in Germany, and now they're back here with us this morning. That's the good news. The bad news is they're not staying here with us this morning. They're going to be moving to Fort Worth. So our loss is Fort Worth's gain. And so y'all raise your hand. So if somebody wants to come over and y'all want to go over and hug them after services, that's where they're sitting. I woke up late this morning. I hate when that happens. It was an accident. I accidentally turned over and hit the alarm off on my phone. No, actually, I meant to do that. And so it's been kind of harried and hurried this morning, kind of in a rush. And so in this moment right now, I'm trying to purposely slow down a little bit. I want to ask you to do the same thing, because we have some things from the Father that I want us to hear and take seriously. So let's just pause a moment. Let's ask God to energize us and to help us in this moment. Father, you have promised us your rest. And so I pray that in this moment, as we bring our hearts together, that you would make that rest real for us, that you would help us to hear. And I pray, Father, that in this moment you will pour through me the gift of preaching, that I can share some things that are on, that you have laid upon my heart. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Every week, Kevin Tennell was required to mail a check for $1. And for those of you who are younger, a check is this old-fashioned thing where you would write out an amount to someone, pay to the order of. But he was required, think Venmo. Every week, he was required to mail a check in the amount of $1 to a family that he would rather have forgotten. The Glendon family had sued him for $1.5 million, but they settled for $936 to be paid weekly, $1 at a time, for 18 years. 52 times 18 is 936. Every single week, $1 for 18 years. You see, that's how old Maggie Glendon was when Kevin killed her in a head-on collision. Kevin was convicted of manslaughter. And also drunk driving. He served a jail sentence. He spent 7 years campaigning against drunk driving, actually 6 years longer than the court had required but he kept forgetting to mail the check. The girl's family, Maggie's family, took Kevin to court 4 times for failure to pay the check. After one court appearance, Kevin was put in jail for 30 days. And he insisted that he wasn't trying to defy the order of the court. It's just that he was haunted by the girl's death and he was tormented by the weekly reminders. He offered the family post-dated checks a year more than he actually owed. And he gave like 2 boxes of checks, and they're all signed and they're all post-dated, but they refused. The family refused. It wasn't the money they were after, they said. It was vengeance. Maggie's mother said, "We want that check every week on time. And he's got to understand that we're going to pursue this until he has sent us every single check. We'll take him to court every month if we have to. He will give us every single check." And I would never question that family's anger. But here's what I wonder. Is 936 payments going to be enough? Will this family ever find a sense of rest? And I know they never will. But I mean, will they ever be able to forgive? How much restitution is enough? Now put yourself in that family's place. How many payments would you require? If you were in that situation, better yet, how many payments do you require right now when someone does you wrong? When someone hurts you, what do you require of him or her? How many payments is enough? See, here's the thing. None of us goes through life without being hurt or injured by others in some way. None of us go through life without that happening. Just like Maggie's family, every single one of us is a victim. The girl died because someone drank too much. Maybe a part of you died because someone spoke too much, or because someone demanded too much, or because someone neglected too much. Everyone gets wounded in life. No one is immune. And when you're hurt and you're wounded, you've got to decide how many payments is enough. How many payments will I demand for my offender? Peter asked Jesus, "Lord, how many times should I forgive someone who sins against me? Up to 7 times? That was actually more than what Jewish custom required. And so Peter probably thought Jesus would be impressed, but Jesus wasn't. He said, no. I tell you, not up to 7 times, but to 7 times 7. 77 times. In other words, our forgiveness should never be limited. We should always extend grace to others. And to make the point, to drive home the point, Jesus tells this story. Jack is doing a class on Sunday morning about the stories that Jesus told, and I encourage you to stay after today to hear his class. They're always excellent insights. But to drive the point home, Jesus tells this story that Evan Tardy read about the unmerciful servant, the unforgiving servant, who was forgiven so much and then turned around and demanded payment from someone else, and then who was punished by the master because of that. And there's a lot of points that could be made from the story. I just want to talk about 2 of them, I think, that are central here. And the first one is this: The story tells us that all people are debtors. The man in the story had a serious debt which he could not repay. The NIV says he owed 10,000 bags of gold. 10,000 bags of gold. I don't know how big the bags were, but that's a lot of gold. Another version says that he owed him 50 million silver coins. Either way, the debt was greater than his ability to pay. And of course, the point of the story that we need to get, it's not really about money. For us, it's about sin, because we all have this debt. Romans 3 and verse 23 says, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We, all of us, have this serious spiritual problem, and it's called sin. We, all of us, have this deep indebtedness to our master because of sin. We all are in a deep, dark hole because of sin. Our debt to God is greater than we can pay. One person said it this way: our pockets are empty, while our debt is millions. We don't need a salary, we need a gift. We don't need a place to work, we need someone to work in our place. And that person is Jesus Christ. The biblical writers understood this. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24, he says, Jesus himself bore our sins in his body on the cross so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. By his wounds, by his death, we are healed. We are forgiven. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 21, my absolute favorite verse in all of the New Testament, God made him who had no sin to be sin for us so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Amen? Jesus traded places with us. He became sin and we became righteousness. I read a story about a lady that had been baptized. She'd been converted, and one of her coworkers, they were sitting there at lunch talking, and she said, her coworker said, what's it like to become a Christian? Kind of took the woman, the new Christian, by surprise, and she really didn't know what to say until she looked up and she saw in the office, this was October, in the office there was a smiling jack-o'-lantern, and that kind of triggered something in her mind. She says, well, it's like being a pumpkin. God takes you out of the patch and cleans you up, and then cuts off the top, then digs out all this yucky stuff, all these seeds of anger and doubt and hatred and greed. And then he carves a new smiling face on you. And then he puts his light inside of you to shine to the world. She said, that's what it's like. That's what Jesus has done for me. But that's not bad. God, our master, has forgiven us this unsurmountable debt, this incredibly horrible, weighty guilt of sin, the debt of sin. And God does not require payment from us. He paid for us through Jesus Christ. And so that's the first lesson. We're all debtors, every single one of us, but Jesus has paid the price. The second lesson is, we get this first one kind of. The next one is harder, I think. And that is that all people can become prisoners. The man, the unforgiving servant in our story, was a prisoner before he became a prisoner. He was a prisoner of an unforgiving heart and soul. Someone said the world's worst prison is the prison of an unforgiving heart. The world's worst prison is the prison of an unforgiving heart. I want you to think right now about that person in your life that you have trouble forgiving. The worst prison in the world is the prison of an unforgiving heart. When we refuse to forgive others, what we do is we put ourselves in a dungeon, a prison of hatred and misery and sorrow. What this servant does in the story is just almost unbelievable. How could we think to our, how could this guy do this? How could he possibly do it? I mean, he's forgiven this incredible debt. He's been shown abundant grace, and he doesn't extend it to someone who owes him a piddling few dollars. He assaults and chokes the guy and demands payment. Pay me back what you owe me. That tells me that that guy is ungrateful. Because someone who has been forgiven a huge debt is grateful and doesn't treat people like that. And then this official, this unforgiving servant, demands that his debtor be put in prison. Now, what occurs to me is that if he didn't have the money out of prison, how's he going to get the money if he goes into prison? So not only is this guy ungrateful, he's also foolish. And the point for us is that hatred and unforgiveness, they just don't ever make sense. Not really. Not in the long term. It becomes kind of an addiction, I think, this blind foolishness of unforgiveness. How could someone who has been extended grace not extend it to others? How can someone who has been forgiven not forgive someone else? How can someone who has been shown ultimate kindness not show kindness to someone else? I mean, we do it all the time, but it just doesn't make sense. What do we make of this? How do we figure this out? Why would that happen? Why would I, who am a debtor and have been forgiven so much, why could I possibly find it hard to forgive someone else? Jesus said in Luke chapter 7, verse 47, whoever's been forgiven little loves little. In other words, if we believe that we have only been forgiven a little, or we only needed to be forgiven a little, then we will probably only forgive a little. Reminds me of the story of the woman who went to her preacher and said she wanted to become a Christian. She wanted to be baptized, and they got ready. They got into the baptistry, and everything is always ready except when it floods, right, and floods the auditorium. But he got ready, and they were in the water together, and he said, he took her hand, and he said, okay, I want you to repeat after me. I know that I'm a no good sinner. And the woman didn't say anything. He thought, well, maybe she didn't hear me. He said, I want you to repeat after me. I know that I'm a no good sinner. And she didn't say anything. And so he asked her, he said, don't you want to be saved? She said, yes, but I'm not a sinner. And he said, well, then you can't be saved. Jesus only died for sinners. She said, oh, okay. Then I'm a good sinner. I'm a good sinner. You see, if you view yourself as a good sinner, then you will probably only want to forgive fellow good sinners. But you know the truth. The truth is we're all bad sinners. And in order to forgive others, that's really how we have to see ourselves. When Paul says, I'm the worst of sinners, he wasn't just saying that. He really saw himself that way. That's easy to say, oh, I'm chief of sinners. But I'm not as bad as that guy. I got a lot of sins, but there's that other person over there, my neighbor, that guy's a real sinner. That guy makes me look like a piker when it comes to sin. So I'm not a bad sinner. I'm a good sinner. It's foolish. God's willing to wipe away all of our sins. He guides us to this pool of mercy, and he invites us to bathe. And some people plunge in, and others just kind of stick their toes in a little bit because they don't think they need it that much. Maybe that's the problem with the unforgiving servant. Maybe he never really felt like he needed to be forgiven that much. Didn't understand the grace he'd been extended. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 15 says, see to it that no one falls short of the grace of God, that no bitter root grows up to cause trouble and defile many. I think there's a key here. I think when we will not forgive, it means we do not understand the grace of God. We do not understand what we have been forgiven. When the grace of God is missed, then bitterness is born in our hearts. When the grace of God is embraced, then forgiveness abounds. And the more we immerse ourselves in the grace of God, the easier it is for us to extend grace to others. This is the key to overcoming unforgiveness. Unforgiveness and hatred. And let me tell you, it is too heavy a burden for you to bear. The hills we have to climb in this life are steep enough without us also having to carry the heaviness of unforgiveness on our backs. The only thing to do with hatred and unforgiveness is to drop them before they drop us. Wouldn't it be great to just let that burden go? Here's the good news. You can. Right now, in this moment, I want you to think about the person you have a hard time forgiving. Draw them up in your mind. Bring them to bear. See their face. See the hurt. They may not even be living anymore. You can let go of that. You can do that right now. So let's just spend a little time with God. A few minutes just to pray. Just to let go. Just to unburden ourselves. Let's pray together, and I'll close us out here in just a moment. We're so thankful, Father, that you've extended your grace to us through Jesus Christ. Father, help us to extend grace to the people in our lives, especially to those that have hurt us deeply, to those we find it difficult to forgive. Father, help us hold on to you more than we hold on to our heart of unforgiveness. We pray that you'll take that load away from us in this moment, right now, today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. Good morning, everyone online. I hope someone told you good morning. I haven't been with you guys for a while, and every time I'm online the last few weeks, I hear babies crying. And I like to hear babies cry because it shows the church is growing, you know, from the strength of the youth. And Tom Zimmer told me, no, that's Bruce Udley crying. And Bruce is sick today and not with us, so I guess that was Bruce crying. But no, we love you, Bruce. As we transition from that into the youth group, I want to highlight that the youth group is definitely one of the highlights of Northside. Young adults interacting within the church body is always beautiful to see. With the leadership of Ben and Rachel Kane, in just a short time, the youth group has flourished and blossomed. Even with COVID-19 being a major factor in staying connected, they found a way to do so, which is great. Please find every opportunity to thank all of them, everyone in the youth group, for their compassion for the Lord, and as well as Ben and Rachel for their dedication. With that said, there are a few upcoming highlights you can mark down on your calendars if you choose to. April the 18th is going to be Sunday Chill, so this afternoon from 4 to 5:30 p.m. at the building. This week, they're working on some other landscaping around the building, so come dressed in some clothes you can get a little dirty and help them out if you choose to. 4/24, which is April 24th, they're going to have their trek meeting. And Saturday evening from 7 to 8:30, this is going to occur in the youth room. This informational meeting is all for the students attending trek this summer, as well as their parents. For those who are unable to attend, they will be recording the meeting and making it available afterwards. May 16th It's going to be Youth Sunday, highlighting our graduating seniors, Sunday morning worship, and Sunday morning class. The youth group will be helping lead worship on this Sunday morning, and they would highlight, the seniors will be highlighted at a special time of prayer, and a presentation of Bibles will be given to them. During our class, they will be celebrating the seniors in the youth room, and the parents of the seniors will have time to take in everything that their children have done throughout their time here at Northside. And then May 23rd, the summer interns will arrive, and everything will start all over again for the upcoming youth in the upcoming year. Again, it's great to see our youth. Everything is going great with them. And again, give them a pat on the back as well as Ben and Rachel. As we transition into the Shepherd's Prayer, we have some prayers and some heavy hearts this morning. Baby girl Phoenix Perry, she's home from the hospital with a heart monitor for the next month. Please keep her in prayer, as well as grandparents Kevin and Sherry Perry, and also dad Timothy Perry. Latasha Teamer, she's home from the hospital, but still could use additional prayers as she deals with her diagnosis. We are not sure what that diagnosis is, but we ask that you keep her and her family in prayer. Prayers also go out for our brother Cecil Dowell, who is the father of Ted Dowell and the Dowell family at the passing of Cecil's sister, Juanita Ortego. She was 95 years old. Please keep them deeply in your prayer because they need it. And prayers also for our brother Landy Gill. Landy passed away a couple of days ago, and it was so sudden, so tragic. I know we've been praying, and we knew that it was a touch-and-go moment, but he did succumb, and we just ask that you continue to keep that family in prayer. They've been through a lot, and they really need our prayers and our comfort and compassion at this time. Services are pending, and we will try to keep you updated as we get news in the coming days. If you would, now go to the Heavenly Father with me in prayer. Most gracious and wonderful Father, thank you for allowing us to come to you. Thank you always, Father, for listening to us, for desiring for us to come to you, especially in the time of need. Father, we thank you so much for all that you do for us. We can't stop thanking you. You hear us always. You are there for us. When we don't know what to say, Father, Lord, we know that you hear us. We thank you for this opportunity to come together today. We thank you for allowing us to be in your presence and for you being in ours. And Father, we thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, help us, mold us, shape us into his image, that we can be more and more like him each and every day. And Father, that you will receive the glory. Father, we pray this morning for baby Phoenix. Pray that you will bless her and watch over her, that you will strengthen her, Father, Lord. We know that she is home, but she's still having a few battles. Pray that you bless her, Father, Lord. Keep her in thy care and bless her family. Bless our sister, Leticia, Father, Lord, and be with her and her family. Help her, Father, Lord, through this difficult time. Father, we know that you know all things, and we know, Father, Lord, you know what is best. Just pray, Father, Lord, that you comfort the family and ease them through this moment that they're going through. We pray also, Father, for the Dow family. Pray, Father, Lord, that you would be with them. We know that services are coming, and we know there'll be a lot of traveling that's going on. We just pray for safe travels and travel mercies, Father, for them. Pray that you would comfort them at this time and give them peace. And Father, we pray for our brother Landy Gill's family. We pray, Father, Lord, that you will be there especially for them. Help us, Father, Lord, here at Northside to do all that we can, Father, Lord, to provide some sort of comfort and hope for them, to be involved in whatever they need done. Help us, Father, Lord, to be able to love on them and continue, Father, Lord, to show them how much we care. Father, it's just so much that goes on in our life, Father, day after day. We always have ups, but we also have downs. But Father, we know that you are always there. You are there when we need you. And Father, you help us to understand that joy has a name, that righteousness has a name, that peace has a name, that compassion has a name, that joy has a name, that forgiveness has a name, that love has a name, and that name is Jesus. We thank you so much for your Son, and it's his name that we pray and ask these things. Amen.
We're grateful for all of you for being a part of this morning's service, not just this gathered crowd here this morning, but also those who are online. We have as many as 100 and often more people, devices that are online. 100 devices probably means 150. Many of those are our own members. We are having an increasing number of folks from different parts of the country who are joining us online. I know at least one from Connecticut, from Illinois, from Colorado, and other places that are part of our church on a regular basis. All of us are part of this community, and we want to see one another and look out for one another and be engaged with one another, whether we are able to be here or worshiping online. Each week we talk at this point about giving, and we have that opportunity this morning. Some of you have asked, how are we doing in our giving? We are a little behind. Let me tell you the more important part. The ministries of this church are roaring back. There are more things going on right now, more excitement, more interest, more dreaming and putting together the pieces for the future that Northside has. These are exciting and important days indeed. Last night at the Engage service out at Sonterra Plaza, we had a whole bunch of folks, and not all of them were from this church, watching the folks gather who knew nothing about our church, participating in the singing. I saw one couple had not intended to say it, come out of the restaurant, listen to the singing, go to the car, get a couple of camp chairs, brought them back out, sat down, and participated in the rest of the service. For this church to be that engaged, not just at this building, but out there, those are the kinds of things that are happening as our youth group, as our children's ministry, as the adult ministries, as life groups, as the connections ministry, on and on and on. We all need to participate in the life and the future of this church. And so we urge you all, if you would, to give online at nscoc.org/give. The text amount, as you see, to 210-940-4401. By sending a check or through bill pay or by putting money or a check in the offering boxes at the back. It's an important part of our commitment to the life and the future of God's work among us. Our classes will begin in about 15 minutes at 10:15. The adult class here, children's classes, the teenage class. The teens will meet here again, as Rod has already shared, at 4 o'clock this afternoon. The new children's Bible lesson video is up and available on our YouTube channel. Be aware of all these activities as we try to keep abreast with the things that God is doing among us. Would you stand, please? We have been forgiven. And may we, as the people of God, forgiven through Christ's blood, be people of grace in this world. Let's sing together.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Amen. Have a great week.